Hey, you all. Farmer Jesse here, going to talk today about perennial cover crops, why they don't work, but subtitle here before you thumbs down this video, how they could. So, let's do it. First things first, if you're not subscribed to this channel, make sure to hit the subscribe button, because if you are subscribed, you're awesome. So, a lot of incentive there. Second thing, it's like cat videos. 6:50 in the morning. As light decreases in the fall, I have less time to make these videos. So I'll try and make as many as I can, but for the meantime, Josh will be helping me put up videos throughout the winter until we can get back to the spring when I have more time so that I can take care of the farm, the family, and the videos. And the podcast and all the other things we do, because as the daylight dives, so does my time. Anyway, just wanted to put that in there because it's not interesting at all. Okay, so perennial cover crops, what are they? Perennial cover crops are essentially a perennial. Clover, Dutch white clover is often recommended. Lots of different things, legumes and etc. For basically a crop that you can just plant into. Right? So not having bare soil, not having just like a mulch, like just a living cover crop that you can plant into. The theoretical benefits of this are that you're able to take advantage of all of that photosynthesis. So you have a crop that is constantly photosynthesizing. You put a crop into that and it's able to take advantage of all the minerals and all the nutrients that have been gathered by that cover crop. Super awesome idea. Not great in practice, in our experience, at least not on a commercial scale, right? You could probably do this for a sustenance scale, and obviously, like, throughout history, people weren't always cultivating their soil. Like, they had lots of different options. But for, like, a market garden context, our experiences, it doesn't work. But I have some ideas for why it doesn't work and how it could be fixed. And real quick, I kind of want to just talk about how I went about this, because I think it'd be a good opportunity to just critique my methodology as well. Because, of course, I don't have, you know, a monopoly on all the good ideas or best experience or best advice. So, anyway, I want to show you that basically this whole plot was a lot of clover. There originally was some rye in it, but I haven't seen any of the rye come back, so I don't think that was here. There's obviously some grasses grown up in it, but primarily white clover, and I mowed it really tight, and then I came through and drilled holes with the auger bit, and transplanted our winter squash into that. So it was basically just like really tightly mowed, transplanted into that, and then I managed the pathways with the mower, you know, throughout the season until these long vines kind of decided that was no longer the case and moved into the pathway, so I no longer had room to do that. That's kind of how this went down. Now, feel free to add on to this in the comment section, add your thoughts, but the first thing that sort of comes up to mind for me is that the crops that we grow are not particularly competitive. They're not bred to be competitive. They're bred for performance in very sterile environments. That's one of the first issues, is that you're planting crops that are kind of bred to be, to basically just compete with themselves in with ample spacing into very dense competition. That can be a struggle. And I find that the first thing that happens when you put those crops into a perennial cover crop is that they yellow. They just are unhappy. And that could be soil temperature, right? It's gonna be cooler under those soils. And it can also just be antagonism, right? Some of those crops do have allelopathic elements. So you want to avoid the allelopaths, but almost every crop is gonna defend itself in some way, especially if it's sharing its rhizosphere at all. And I'm also curious, because in the wild, right, when you have a bunch of plants growing together, you may get some fruit, or you may get some flowers, or whatever it is. You may get some small, but it's always smaller. It's the yield are never the same as in a cultivated environment. And that's very reflected in a perennial cover cropping situation, at least in our experience, where the yields are smaller, the fruit is smaller. We've done this with okra, we've done this with cucurbits. We've planted various things in various levels of deteriorated cover crops too. So we have a lot of experience of like fighting those root systems, those sort of still alive root systems. And mostly our experience is that it reduces the size of the crop. This is actually reflected in research too. If you look into critical period of weediness or critical period of weed control, the thing is, when crops have too much competition at a certain stage of their life, they produce less. They produce more foliage maybe, but they produce smaller fruit. So that's something that we've run into when we're playing with perennial cover crops. Now, do I think that I should totally throw the idea out? No. What I think is that it's could work for certain crops, specific crops in specific situations. Now, nothing intensive. I don't think it's ever going to work for lettuces or baby greens. I don't think it's ever going to work for maybe even like your less competitive crops like cucurbits. Maybe for things that are a little bit more competitive like nightshades. Few things that I think do have to change in order for it to work, or things that you have to think about, are one, yes, the crop, the variety of crop, something more competitive. But two, space around the crop. It has to have probably a solid foot that is blocked off specifically with a mulch or cardboard or something where there's no, where there are no weeds right up against the crop. And honestly, that should happen. That spot should be set up probably 2 weeks before a plant goes in, just so those roots kind of die back. And I like the idea of cardboard, something that's a physical barrier between the crop and the perennial cover crop. And in fact, somebody came up to me at the Oak conference and showed me how they basically take big cement blocks. I wish I had a picture of this. Big cement blocks and put them into their yard, and they fill that with soil and they plant and they grow these really beautiful crops in these like weird cement blocks. And I love seeing gardening techniques, like home scale gardening techniques, because you can always figure out a way to scale those up. So in my mind, something like cardboard, something like a heavy mulch, plant into that, but you leave a lot of space right around the crop. Which kind of just brings me to sort of perennial pathways, right? Like that's really what I'm talking about. If you're gonna do an intensive management like that, something like a perennial pathway that you can mow makes more sense than having like a entire plot or garden set up in a perennial cover crop, right? The pathway, you have the pathway divided from the actual bed, growing beds, and I think that just makes way more sense. The other thing I think we also have to be doing in order for this to work at all, which I think it could, and I think it would make very nutrient-rich food. I'd love to see the nutrient content of these fruits versus like a butternut squash grown in like just the field. The other thing we have to be doing though is breeding crops to be more competitive. So you'd have to be breeding them in a situation that is more competitive to sort of encourage them to turn on those genes, to figure that out. Because you're not gonna get a really competitive crop seed from your average breeder who's breeding them in a sort of monoculture system. I think that if we solve those couple of few things, did I say two or three? I don't know. If we solve those couple or two things, then I think there's a potential for sort of having a hybrid system where you have more living roots in the soil, more clovers and stuff in the pathway, that you can also get a marketable, manageable crop out of it. Anyway, that's it. Add your thoughts. Appreciate you watching. It's like work time now. So, I'll see y'all later. Thanks for watching. Like this video if you like this video. I usually say that first, I'll say it last. All right, bye. Where have you been?